introducing yourself. First, your name, your related teaching experience, and your course. Just very high level detail, you know, high level introduction, and one word to describe your course, like one unique word. Okay, go ahead.
Okay, so Mr. Dixon, and leadership and conflict resolution. There's tons of those classes, especially leadership is such a general word. And why do we want to sit in your class? By the way, I just want to let you know and everybody know your class is pretty much booked. The younger kids, we have the 13 to 16, it's also booked. And we have maybe one or two spots for the 17 and above. So, but anyway, we still want to hear about your classes.
And go ahead, Mr. Dixon.
Thank you. First of all, I want to take all the other classes because they all sound very interesting. But I also want to make an observation as to how passionate the teachers are. As I listen to my other three associates, so I'm just taken by how passionate they are about teaching. And I don't think you can teach well without being passionate. So I'm happy to be among such brilliant, passionate people. I think we cannot go into the world any longer without understanding how to manage conflict. I had the pleasure of speaking with someone at MIT on Thursday, and he's innovating on flying cars. And so the flying car doesn't sound like it's that far away. I see what's happening on Mars and all the photographs that's coming back from Mars, and we're going to colonize Mars. And look at all the technological things we have to us. And so my class is really a question and it's an invitation. If we have these great technologies and we can have flying cars and go to Mars, and if you can live to be 100 years old and now there's CRISPR technology where we can make almost the perfect human, if we have all those two things, but we don't know how to live with each other, then we really haven't accomplished anything. Because if we go to Mars and we behave on Mars as we are behaving on Earth, I don't know if we would call that progress. We'll just take the same behavior we have here and mimic it and copy what we're doing here on Mars. So it begs the question, what do we need to do differently? And I would say to you, what we need to do differently is to manage conflict well. My course isn't to teach you how not to have conflict. My course is to teach you how to have conflict in ways that leads to innovation, in ways that leads to intimacy, in ways that leads to your understanding better aspects of yourself. So one of the first questions about conflict is, what is conflict? What are the different styles of conflict? What is my biases? What is my prejudices? What is my culture that may prevent me from hearing or listening to another person that I may love? It might be my wife, or it might be my mother, it might be my brother, it might be my sister. If I'm a leader, if I'm innovating in technology and I go into computer science and I go into the world and I'm going to lead the world in this technology that I discover or that I have a passion for, how do I lead in a way that creates greater ecosystems of integration so that we don't have conflict? Let me change that. So we have conflict, but we have conflict that leads to innovation. We have conflict that leads to transparency. Do I have time to just give a quick antidote of this, Dandan?
Yeah, no, go ahead. Yes, we have time. Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So here is a conflict that brought people together. It's a very painful one, but it's the power of the conflict to let you know that managing conflict can lead to something quite extraordinary. I have a dear friend here whose son was unfortunately killed. He was a freshman in college, and while his son was going to school, his son was a pizza delivery boy part-time. And so someone called up the pizza place. My friend's son went there, and unfortunately, someone took his life. Of course, that was his only child, and it destroyed him, it devastated him. But you know, he did something quite extraordinary. He wanted to know who the boy was that killed his son, right? Now, this is his only son. He went and he met the boy, and he saw it was a young boy. The boy was 14 years old. He wanted to know the boy's background. He learned the boy came from a pretty terrible background. His parents weren't there. His grandfather was raising him. And unfortunately for the little boy, He had to spend 20 years in prison. Now, if you lost a son like that, you would think the world is a terrible place. You'd be very angry, you'd be very hurt. And my friend was all those things. He was very angry, he was very hurt. But he said, you know, I really wanted to know who this boy was. And so when the boy had to go to prison, my friend visited him, got to know him, asked the boy to get his high school diploma. The boy got his high school diploma. And one day the boy asked my friend, would you forgive me for taking your son's life? This is pretty terrible. And my friend said, yes, I will. I will forgive you for the death of my son, for you taking my son's life. Now, I want to say something. This boy had to do 20 years in prison. When he went in, he was 14. He's now 34 and he's out. And my friend has hired him. Listen to this. My friend has hired him to work with his company. And they're going to go on to various schools across the country. They've been to the United Nations already and talk about peace and reconciliation. And this boy who took my friend's son's life gets on stage and he says, hi, my name is Tony. I took the life of Mr. Azim Kamisa's son and Mr. Kamisa has forgiven me. And I want to tell you the story of my life so you don't do it. So I spoke with Azim Kamisa, the father, not so long ago. And I said, how was your day? I want you to listen to this story. It's quite powerful. I said, how was your day? And he said, I had a beautiful day. I said, what did you do? He said, I sat with Tony. I had lunch with Tony. And I said, how was it? He said, Tony is so smart. He's so beautiful. I love him. And you know, think of all the lives we're going to change because Tony and I are going to go and talk to kids across the nation about gang violence. And Tony and I are going to change the world. I love Tony. So here's a really, and I'm giving you a short version of this story, but here's a terrible story of a father losing a son. And there was conflict. He didn't agree that this boy should have harmed his family. But he said, you know, I had to forgive him. And through my forgiving him, we have changed the lives of so many kids. So over the years, Tony and Azim Kamisa have gone to school. They've spoken to over 10,000 kids. Some are in Berkeley, some are at Harvard, some are all universities across the country. And the kids come back and they say to Azim and to Tony, you changed my life. So through a tragedy, through something very, very horrible, and through forgiveness, which we call empathy, there was this conflict that happened that actually ended up changing the lives of a number of people. I don't think you will have that kind of conflict in your life. At least I hope you don't. But I said this to show that irrespective of how difficult the conflict, there's always a way to manage the conflict. Last thing I will say, I'm looking at you guys and thinking of you guys as the future leaders of this country. And my question to you is, can you lead in a way that really builds ecosystem of transparency and trust and innovation and competition? Because the world needs leaders like that.
Wow, what a speech. Thank you. We're all taking a class right now, Mr. Dixon. Very, very, I'm you know, almost tears in my eyes. I'm very touched. And both of you, Ms. Luxton, and you also mentioned the word of empathy. So I really want to share with all of you at Haddee and also Nextstream, we're not just a funding educational company to like, okay, hurry up, get into the Ivy League, this and that. Okay, that's probably one of the goals for some students, not all. We really emphasize empathy education and the compassion education. That's why we have internship for older kids to help young kids through compassion and through empathy. It's not just a competition, it's for collaboration. So thank you, Mr. Dixon. And we'll delve into, I think more people will have questions about your class. Mr. Dixon, and will your class be having homework or assignment? And these days in Zoom, we're very comfortable with Zoom, but a lot of teenagers are not comfortable turning on their camera. They're not comfortable in talking. And how do you get your students talking? Because I feel they talking to each other is very important. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Resolve conflict. Yeah, so we're really going to look at the anatomy of conflict. We're really going to look at what is conflict, what are conflict styles, different points of view, biases. I've actually had my curriculum here, steps up for resolving interpersonal conflict. If you're a student in college and university, how do you work with a difficult professor? How do you work with a difficult friend or difficult fellow students? And most fundamentally is, what is communication? How do we communicate? Particularly in with difficult conversations. And so one of the things we'll do to make the class real is when I may invite the students to talk about a particular problem they have, or something or some issue they may be dealing with, whether it's in class or in their personal lives, or just something that they're looking at or considering in the world. I'm looking at this particular situation, and how do I look at it in a way that invites me to have a conversation with it? So conflict really is an invitation to have a conflict, an invitation to have a conversation with the person that you're in opposition with. The homework, I may invite you to practice certain principles of conflict in between our meetings. I may invite you to watch a movie that speaks to a particular style of managing conflict, and then come back and talk about it. There are definitely books that we can reference. I won't ask you to read them. I'll ask you to maybe peruse them or look at a certain chapter or look at certain elements of a book. But the homework is really would be, most fundamentally would be on really practicing the principles that we're talking about for this particular course. We'll talk about maybe empathic listening. Then I'll ask you to maybe practice that with your mom and dad, or practice that with a friend or a colleague that you may have difficulty with, and then come back and let me know how successful you were in managing conflict. You know, managing conflict is such a complex thing, and it's really the foundation of everything we do. If we say life, we say conflict, right? I mean, life is conflict, we can't evade it. And I really, really want to say to the students listening, my job here with you for the 8 weeks we're together is not to remove conflict from your life, right? Because life is conflict. My role and my job and our time together is to really look at how we go into conflict and how we participate in it. How do we participate in the nature of conflict? Because it's in everything we do. It's in the very air we breathe. And so how do we go into it? Because it's here. And how do we have conversations with it? So you will have homework, but the homework would really be practicing some of the principles of conflict we'll be talking about. And we'll have a lot of fun. It does require you to turn your camera on. There's no other way for me to do that. So I do have to see your face, but we'll have fun. We'll break into groups. We'll have exercises. We'll have you talk with each other and do exercises with each other. So it will be highly interactive.
Okay,